Recorded Books Incorporated presents an unabridged recording of I Am Mordred, a tale from Camelot by Nancy Springer. Narrated by Steven Crossley.
Prologue. Because he was the king, he could show no feeling about this. The wind blew cold off the sword-grey sea, and over his crowned head the crying gulls wheeled, and at his booted feet on the black sand lay 40 naked babies, crying louder than the gulls. And from behind the tangle of wrack at the tideline, his men-at-arms watched silently. Because he was the king, he would not ask them to do this thing. He was only a beardless youth, but his was the head that wore the crown, and his was the evil deed that had led them to this chill shore, and his was the fate spiralling out of the deed, and his would be the shame. Moored to the quay, riding on the ebbing tide, waited an unmanned coracle without tiller or sail, a bare, frail, wood and leather shell of a boat. There was no putting it off any longer. Because he was the king, he had to do this thing. He stooped, lifted two of the wailing babies from the sand, one in each arm, and walked to the quay, and placed the infants gently in the boat's open, wicker-floored hull. Again he did this, and again until he lost count, and the boat rode heavy with babies. Boy babies, all of them. His cloak fell back from his shoulders and he felt the cold wind cutting into him from the sea. But because of the crying of the babies, and because he was the king, he did not draw the cloak around himself. It was a strange, exalted and terrible thing to be the king. Everything he did sent out echoes, like a great bell. He had not understood soon enough what it was to be the king. He had thought more of being a man, and no longer a boy, and he had made a serious mistake. All mortals make mistakes, but when the king made a mistake, then the sky clouded, the corn grew short, women wept, hundreds of men marched into battle, and 40 babes were brought to the sea to die. Why did they all have to die? It would have been a wicked shame enough to slay the one. But Merlin had spoken. Let all male babies of the nobility born on May Day be brought to the shore. That was the sort of thing that happened when the king did wrong. Two by two, he carried the babies to the coracle. They howled, they squirmed in his arms, they squalled. The wind rose and whipped the king, the coracle, the sea. The sky clouded and wept long lashes of rain. The babes formed a pile in the belly of the coracle now, their flesh a cold, pearly pink like the insides of whelk shells. The king returned to the shore for the last two. They struggled and wailed in his arms. No. One of them lay as still as dawn, its silky head resting in the curve of his elbow, its dark eyes gazing up at his face. He looked down at it, and its eyes, like deep pools of indigo, took him in for a moment, like a spell. That sober, dark-eyed, gazing babe. It was his. It was the one. He knew it. He looked away, blinking out at the sea. He could show no weakness, for he was the king. He placed the dark-eyed babe gently in the coracle with the others, for he had no choice. The well-being of the realm depended on him. He cast off the mooring of the coracle and pushed it away from the quay. It rode heavily on the salt water, swollen with babies, its leather sides bulging. The tide carried it out to sea, a little farther from land each time a wave broke on the shore. He stood on the quay and watched as the grey bobbing coracle blended into the grey rain, the sword-grey sea, until he could not tell the crying of the doomed babes from the crying of the gulls. Book 1. The White Shadow. Chapter 1. When I was a baby, my father tried to kill me. I am Mordred, speaking to you from the wind with a raven's thin black tongue. I am Mordred, and it is no easier to say now than it ever was. Even hundreds of years ago, when I was human and young, when I first looked wide-eyed upon Camelot, it was hard to be who I was. Mordred, the shadow on all that shone, the bad seed. Because I am Mordred, my father placed me naked in a coracle, a frail cockleshell of a boat, and cast me adrift on the sea. I was too young to remember the days of starvation, the nights of cold. I do not remember my own crying. And I did not at first know that I was Mordred, and I did not at first think to hate my father, because my fisher mother taught me no hatred. While she told me no lies, she kept me from the whole truth of those harsh days. Here is the way she would tell the tale to me. Once upon a time, she would say, there was a poor common woman who was very unhappy. That was you, Mama. I bounced in my bed until the straw rustled, for I had heard this tale many times in my 6 years, the true, amazing tale of myself, and I loved it. She had told it to me almost every day since I could remember. Her round brown face would crinkle with a smile as she went on, pretending I hadn't spoken. A poor fisherman's wife. She was unhappy because her baby had died and she had waited so long. And then, to lay the poor little stranger in the ground, well, it was hard. The milk stung in her breasts, and the tears stung in her eyes, and she could not think of food or eating. She sat by the cold hearth and cried. But then, what do you think happened? The fisherman found me, I shouted. Shh, softly, little one. Yes, it was uncanny. Her smile turned rapt. And in the back of her words, I grew aware of the vast sea sighing and stirring and muttering like a sleeper outside our window. Like a miracle. The good fisherman walked down to see to his nets, and there, beached almost at his door, what should he see but a fine coracle? And in the coracle, what should he find but a wee naked baby boy, cold and hungry but still alive? That was me. Yes, dear one, that was you. Now there was a bright glimmer in her smiling eyes. The good fisherman picked you up and carried you against his chest, under his tunic, to warm you. And he hurried to me. From his place by the fire, my fisher father grumbled, I should have seen to the coracle first. Hush, you! Fisher mother spoke gently, because she knew he was teasing. He was a dank, silent man, as crusty as the salt on his nets, but she had an understanding with him. She went on with the story. He hurried to me where I sat weeping, and he gave you into my arms, poor wee babe, so weak and starved that you could barely cry. Yet when I offered you the breast, you suckled strongly, like a miracle. And when he turned again to the sea, the coracle was gone. As if it had never been. As if it had never been. Yes. Uncanny. My fisher father growled. The sea took it back, that's all. But the sea was calm, and never a splinter of that coracle did we see again. My fisher mother spoke almost in a whisper. Old Lear had heard me crying, I think. Lear was the god of the sea, who allowed fisher father's boat on his wide slumbering chest in the summer, but shook the hut with purple storms in the cold of the year. I knew the power of Lear. Old Lear had grown weary of hearing my crying and sent you to dry my tears, little one. I lay quieted by the wonder of the story. Now go to sleep, Tad, my fisher mother patted me. She called me Tad because I had come to her naked like a wriggling little tadpole from the sea. Oh, look! There is the mark of Lear's kiss. She always made a show of discovering it, a brownish mark like an X behind my left ear. She kissed me there. Sleep in peace. And so I did. The murmuring of the sea was my lullaby, and my belly was full. I never went hungry. The haddock leap into the nets, my fisher father said sometimes in wonder. Thank the goodliness of our blessed King Arthur. For it was the sole honour of the king that made the fish fat and plentiful. But I did not dream of Arthur king in Camelot, not in those periwinkle days when I was Tad. The hut was warm and the sea breathed marvels in my ear, and in my sleep I dreamed sometimes that the waves rocked me in their watery arms. I did not know myself to be bad seed cast away, and I did not think to wonder who was my real father or my real mother, for my fisher mother had told me that I was a gift from Lear. The sea was my father and my mother. And in the morning there would be warm white chowder to eat, and all day I would leap on the rocks and wade the shallows and run with the plovers on the gravel shore, and the sea was vast, and the sky vast all around me. And I stood, a god's gift, over the sea amidst the sky, and the forest perilous was only a low blue mystery in the distance. And at night there would be kippered herring for supper, and the warmth of fisher mother's arms and my story at bedtime, and I was happy. It is instructive, looking back now that I am no longer mortal, instructive and curious to remember how it was to be happy. All changed, of course, before I was strong enough already, on a summer day, when a lady in green came riding on a great grey horse out of the forest perilous. I saw her approaching, for I was gathering birds' eggs on the rocks, and as I squatted by the basket, I glanced up and saw the horse shining like a mussel pearl against the darkness that was the forest. Speckled eggs dropped from my hands and cracked open at my feet. Crouching, I gawked at the horse and rider, for I had never seen such a thing, though I had heard of lords and ladies in the stories my fisher mother told me. But to really see, it was beyond believing. A lady, a real lady, riding past our hut. I left my basket and ran to tell my fisher mother to come out and see. In a moment I stood before the hut, so breathless, not from running but from wonder, that I could barely speak. But Mama was already at the door, staring. And the lady sent the horse at a long floating trot straight toward us. So this was a lady. I did not yet know enough to find it odd that she rode alone. She sat half sideward on the horse, and her gown flowed down like leaf-green water around her feet, covering them. I thought at first that she might not have feet. She seemed so different from my stout brown fisher mother standing in the hut's low doorway. The lady's skin lustered as smooth and pale as moonlight. Her hair, the colour of a red hawk, lay in sleek, parted wings over her ears, then swept into plaits bound with criss-cross ribbons of the same green as her shimmering gown, ending in clasps of gold. The plaits hung so long they lay like whiplashes against the horse's flanks, making it snort as it trotted toward us, a great dapple-grey horse. Any horse would have seemed huge to me, for I had never seen one. But in truth, this was a courser, a charger with massive shoulders and a mighty arched neck. A destrier, not a lady's gentle palfrey. My nose scarcely reached higher than the horse's knees as it halted before me. There I stood in my coarse brown tunic, bare-legged, a child with a mouth like an O, agape at the sight of the lady upon the great grey horse, gazing up at her face, at her skin like moonlight, her eyes dark and secret like deep pools at midnight. I looked up at her, and she looked back at me and smiled, a merry, tender smile as if we shared a jest.
Well met, Mordred, she said.
My fisher mother wept, even though Nineveh gave her a purse of gold. That was the lady's name, Nineveh, and she was a sorceress. The snorting charger stood as still as the dapple-grey moon in the sky when she alighted and touched it on the forehead. She touched my fisher mother's rough hair and said, It is not so bad. I feel life in you. You are with child again. You will have a fine son, and miss this one the less. I did not yet understand. Nor did I understand how or why she called me Mordred, though I sensed at once that it was truly my name. Looking into Nineveh's eyes as she said it, I had recognized the name the way I recognize sharp flints under my bare feet.
But why not leave the child here? My fisher mother cried. They cast him away. They do not want him. No one has to know.
But I know, Nineveh said. And if I discovered him, so can Morgan Le Fay.
I did not know who Morgan was. I knew only that a fay was a sorceress of the other world. I heard what Nineveh was saying, but no one had ever hurt me, or not within my memory, so I did not yet feel afraid. I was still gazing at Nineveh. She wore no belt, but a green baldric hung from her left shoulder across her breast to her right hip, and from the baldric hung a golden dagger with a glimmering dark stone in the hilt. I had never seen such a fine dagger. Already I wanted one like it when I grew up.
He will be safer in the castle at Lothian, Nineveh said.
My fisher mother sank to her knees weeping, but Nineveh turned to me and lifted me lightly and placed me upon the withers of the horse amid the grey mane which flowed heavily like rain down its neck. Then, just as lightly, she mounted. She gathered me onto her lap and said to my fisher mother as she lifted the reins,
May the lady, my mistress, ease your pain.
And then we rode away. I was so taken by the golden dagger and the lady and the great grey steed that I did not weep or say farewell. Also, I did not understand. The courser surged and curvetted under us, ramping onward three times as fast as a man could walk.
Do you like to ride the horse, Mordred? Nineveh asked me.
Yes. You're a true noble.
I heard a quirk in her voice as if she might laugh at me.
I am a noble?
I asked, astonished. Though I knew I was the gift of Lear to my fisher mother, I had never thought otherwise than that I was a young churl, fit to run carefree by the sea.
You are more than noble, she said.
Her voice was soft and made me think of wild roses, as did the softness of her pale pink mouth, as did her fragrance, light and fresh and free.
You are a king's son.
It felt astounding at first, but then fitting, that I, the gift of Lear and the son of my fisher mother's sky, was a prince. I sat taller on the horse, and Nineveh's moon-white hand curled around my narrow, childish chest to restrain me.
What king?
I demanded. She hesitated.
Who is my father?
It was the first time in my life that I had thought to ask.
Softly, Mordred.
Something troubled her quiet voice like wind over still water.
Softly. There are those who say you were born for ill. Those who might wish to kill you yet.
That jarred me. For a moment I struggled for breath.
You must trust me, she said, her voice even softer. I am one who hopes for good from you.
She paused while I listened to the clashing of the horse's hooves and my own harsh breathing. Then, almost in a whisper, she said,
Perhaps the only one.
That night, we camped in the forest perilous. We rode until dark amid the twisted witch elms, the looming oaks heavy with druid vine, the black hemlocks. Up until the moment Nineveh's great grey steed carried me into the forest perilous, I had thought the world was made of sunshine and cloud sheen and open sky and open sea. Where I lived, or where I used to live, trees grew not at all. But here they grew so thickly and so tall, oak, beech, rowan, hazel, that I could not see the sky. Something crashed away between the trees. Something cried out. Mazy trails led in all directions like tunnels, and within three strides I did not know where I was. That was the day the world closed in on me, dim and glass green and labyrinthine. And though I did not know it then, it was the world in which I would ride for the rest of my life. The Forest Perilous cloaked the kingdom from its stony northern shoulders down to Camelot and the sea, mantling it in shadow. Even as a bare-legged child, I wanted to be brave and good, so I shivered but said nothing. In silence, I rode where Nineveh and her courser carried me. Dim yellow sundown turned to grey twilight. In the hemlocks, someone laughed. We rode on. Twilight turned to nightfall. Swaying in some wind I couldn't even feel, a tall elm groaned like a human. Perhaps it had been something not human that had laughed also. Or perhaps an outlaw. A dead branch thudded to the ground just behind us. The horse leaped forward. Somewhere a bird barked once, then was silent. Some tendril I could not see brushed my face. I pressed against Nineveh's chest, trembling. Nineveh stretched out one hand, and in her palm grew a flame to light the night. She held it there, yellow like a baby chick nesting in the cup of her hand, and she said, "Let us find a place to stop." She chose a dell encircled by sighing elms. "Fire first," she said as she slipped down from her mount and lifted me down to stand wobbly-legged beside her. "Help me gather wood, Mordred." She held the flame in one hand while she heaped my arms with sticks. And then she knelt and laid the fire and lit it with a touch. When the campfire blazed, she closed her hand and the flame in her palm was gone. She unsaddled the horse and hobbled it, then sat by the fire and cuddled me against her side with her left arm and said, "Now be quite still, and I will cozen us some supper." I was terrified of her. I adored her, and my awe of her made my dread of the forest seem less. Fear had warmed me out, and her warmth and the warmth of the fire comforted me. Or perhaps she had put a small spell on me. I lay in her embrace and dozed. I awoke only when I sat up and my eyes widened. I had never seen such a thing. A peacock, a shimmering blue peacock, squatted by our campfire with its long neck stretched down, its head on the ground, its golden eyes fixed on Nineveh. The firelight gilded the great fan of its tail feathers, lifted to salute her. She left my side, bent over the bowing peacock, took it in her soft white hands, and with one easy stroke cut off its head with her dagger. She saw me gawking. "Go back to sleep, Mordred," she said, and I did so, at once. Some time later she awakened me and gave me roast peacock to eat, and sweet purple berries and mushrooms the size of bread loaves. After we had eaten, Nineveh gave me her cloak for a blanket. Then, with no covering for herself except her green gown, she lay down on the other side of the fire from me and slept. But I could not sleep again. Night in the Forest Perilous echoed full of voices. I heard owls conversing, a fox's chuckle, the distant song of wolves, somewhere the dark baying of a hound. Nineveh sprang to her feet. "To horse, Mordred, quickly!" She tore the hobbles from the steed and vaulted onto it, hauling me up behind her, riding bareback and astraddle with her skirt flying around her knees as the charger sprang into a pounding gallop. I clung to her waist, and she swayed over the horse's mane as we thundered through the Forest Perilous with the trees whipping and tearing at both of us in the darkness. I cried out, but no one heard me, for in that moment the night rang with the belling of hounds, many hounds, and the wind rose to a roar, and the trees creaked and groaned and lashed all around us as if they were no mightier than grass. The whirlwind tore the clouds. The moonlight flooded through, and I saw a great white stag leaping between the trees, its antlers shining like a golden crown. The horse stopped, or Nineveh halted it somehow by the power of her hand, as the stag surged past us so close that I saw the flash of its wild eye white with terror. Just behind it swept a pack of black hounds like a storm cloud scudding across the ground. The stag leaped white into the black hemlocks, and I saw it no more. The hounds plunged after it, gone in the night. All the Forest Perilous seemed as still as the moonlight now, with no sound but the baying of the hounds dying away. "I want you to remember what you have just seen," said Nineveh. I was shaking, not only with the cold. "Why?" I whispered. It was the first time I had dared to question her. But without answering me, she turned the horse and sent it walking through the night. The dark song of the hounds sounded faintly across the wilderness, seeming to come from everywhere. Nineveh and I rode gently into the moonlight. She had said I was a prince, but I sounded not at all like a prince as I said to her, "I want to go home." My voice quavered. She said nothing but reached forward and stroked the horse's mane, and under her hand the coarse hair plaited itself into 100 fine braids, and from the tip of each braid sprang a golden bell. Then she reached back and touched her own green baldric, and it hung fringed with golden bells. As the destrier strode on, the bells spoke like angels singing, so that we rode in an enchantment made of their ringing. I could no longer hear the black hounds. Though the chill of the forest lay on my bare legs, I no longer shivered. But amid the ringing of Nineveh's bells, I seemed also to hear the ringing of the bluebells clustered around the great heavy-mossed boles of the trees. And the ringing of bluebells is an omen. The grey horse walked through the silver night, and every stride took me farther from my home. I did not weep. Already, I wanted to be strong, a man. I had decided I would not cry. But I began to understand. I was never to see my fisher mother again. Chapter 2. For 5 years, I believed that I was the son of King Lothar of Lothian. Even though folk gave me sidelong looks and snickered, I did not know what else to believe. Nineveh took me there to Lothian, a cold northern kingdom where the trees grew few and low and twisted, where goats grazed around the castle. Not a castle really, but a hill fortress, a stronghold of rough-hewn rock. On the blunt towers squatted ravens looking for dead sheep. It was a rude place, but at the time I thought it was a castle, and I did not know what I was doing there, for my awe of Nineveh kept me silent. I had not asked her. When we came to Lothian, she did not take me to King Lothar, not at first. Instead, she led me to the chamber of the lady of the castle, Queen Morgause, in a white linen wimple that hid her neck and her hair, sitting at the window with her needlework. Nineveh stood straight before her, but bowed her head for a moment. Nineveh wore a peacock feather in her hawk-red hair, and her long plaits swung free. "Greetings, daughter of Igraine," Nineveh said in her wild rose voice. Queen Morgause looked up at her without speaking. She had a pale, smooth face that seemed to close like a soundless white door. "My lady, surely you have not forgotten the usages of a scrying mirror?" Nineveh said gently. "Do you not know why I am here?" The queen's dark, unblinking eyes turned to me. She did not nod or speak. "Mordred," Nineveh beckoned me forward. "Come, give greeting. This is your lady mother." Nineveh had left me in my rough fisher lad's garment. At the time I wondered why, feeling the chill of the stony castle on my bare legs, seeing even the serving lads garbed more grandly than I was, knowing that Nineveh could have clothed me in princely raiment with a touch of her magical hands. But now I think she was wise, for she meant my mother to take pity on me. I trotted up and dropped to one knee as Nineveh had instructed me to do, and I knelt very still. My mother was a great lady, Nineveh had told me. My mother was Queen Morgause, daughter of Igraine, half-sister of King Arthur himself. I gazed up at her. For if, such a great lady, my mother smiled upon me, then I would stand up strong and golden, and I would truly be a prince, and I would forget my fisher mother. She drew back the hair behind my left ear and looked at the mark there. Then she offered me her soft white hand to touch, and she gave me fair greeting.
"Welcome, Mordred, my son."
But she did not smile. A few moments later, in the great hall, Nineveh presented me to King Lothar. I knelt before him while he looked me over as if studying a new kind of dog, and I tried not to cringe. King Lothar was a hard, grey man with battle scars on his face that showed even under his beard. I tried not to look at his left hand, for two fingers were lopped off. When he had finished scanning me, he said to Nineveh, hard and forthright as the castle stones,
"Very well, we will shelter him here, and we will give him a nobleman's upbringing, for he is of noble blood. But if King Arthur wants him killed, I will not go to war for his sake."
My bare legs twitched. I began to shiver. "It was Merlin who wanted him killed," Nineveh said quietly. "Now that Merlin is gone, Arthur will let him be." I was in awe of Nineveh, as I have said, not even knowing that it was she who had besotted the great wizard Merlin and locked him in his tomb. And I was yet more in awe of her when I saw the anger on King Lothar's warrior face, when I saw that there was much he wished to say to her, yet he reined in his wrath and said little. He said only,
"Does Arthur know he is alive?"
"I shall tell him. Cherish the child well."
King Lothar, so I was later told, had been one of the five rebel kings defeated by King Arthur. And it was a hard thing to be defeated by a beardless boy king of 15. But King Arthur had allowed King Lothar to keep his title and land in exchange for peace and fealty. At first, Lothar had used peace only to plan for more war. But now he had reason for peace. Arthur had no son, so therefore King Lothar's son Gawain, Arthur's sister's elder son, stood as heir to King Arthur's throne. King Lothar must have wondered much when Nineveh brought me to him, whether he would be better off to cherish me as she told him to, or kill me. But I did not know these things then. There was a feast that night in Nineveh's honour. King Lothar sat at the centre of the raised table, Nineveh at his right hand, cutting her meat daintily with her golden dagger. I sat near the end by my mother, Queen Morgause, so that she could see to me. I wore a blue woolen tunic that she had found for me and blue breeches bound about my legs with criss-cross strips of red leather. And I felt strange and grand, even though they were only faded old clothes of Garrett's. I had two brothers, I found, Gawain and Garrett.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.